Isaiah chapter 7. Verse 1 says, when I would have healed Israel, then the iniquity of Ephraim was discovered and the wickedness of Samaria, for they commit falsehood, and a thief cometh in, and a troop of robbers spoileth without. This word falsehood is sheker, number 8267, and it means deception. So Yah says, when I would have healed Israel, then iniquity in Ephraim was discovered. Well, when is the time that he's speaking of, you know, when he was healing Israel, but then the iniquity of Ephraim was discovered in the wickedness of Samaria? It's even found in scripture in 2 Kings chapter 14, verses 23 through 27. If I can have my first reader read 2 Kings chapter 14, verses 23 through 27, please.
1 Kings 14, beginning
at
verse 23. In the 15th year of Amaziah, the son of Joash, king of Judah, Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king over Israel, began to reign in Samaria, and reigned 41 years. And he did that which was evil in the sight of Yahuwah. He departed not from all the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin. He restored the border of Israel from the entering of Hamath unto the Dead Sea, according to the word of Yahuwah Elohim of Israel, which he spake by the hand of his servant Jonah, the son of Amittai, the prophet, who was of Gath-Hepher. For Yahuwah saw the affliction of Israel, that it was very bitter, for there was not any shut up, nor any left, nor any helper for Israel. And Yahuwah said not that he would blot out the name of Israel from under heaven, but he saved them by the hand of Jeroboam, the son of Joash.
Amen. So we see here that Yahuwah did, in fact, go to heal Israel. You know, but there was a problem. And the problem is given in verse 24. It says, speaking of Jeroboam, it says, he departed not from all the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin. You know, he started off doing a real good job. You know, Yah was using him to heal Israel. But then he stopped short. He didn't complete the process. You know, he fell victim to the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin. And just what was this thing? Well, we find it in 1 Kings chapter 12, verses 28 through 32. Can I have my next reader read 1 Kings chapter 12, verses 28 through 32?
Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, it is too much for you to go up into Jerusalem, behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And he set the one in Bethel and the other in Dan. And this thing became a sin, for the people went to worship before the one, even unto Dan. And he made an house of high places, and made priests of the lowest of the people, which were not of the sons of Levites. And Jeroboam ordained a feast in the eighth month, on the 15th day of the month, like unto the feast that is in Judah. And he offered upon the altar, So he did in Bethel, sacrificing unto the calves that he had made, and he placed in Bethel the priest of the high places which he had made.
Okay, so this is the thing that became sin, and this is the thing. This was the sin of Jeroboam, son of Nebat. Okay, now you see where it says, "Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Mitzrayim or Egypt."
Yes.
And where it says in 32, "And Jeroboam ordained a feast."
Yes.
Okay, now I want you to take that and put it on the shelf for a while. We're going to come back to that later. So just remember, put it on the shelf, but don't forget about it. All right?
Yeah.
All right, now he says that he set one in Bethel. Bethel means the house of Elohim.
Wow.
And he put the other in Dan. Dan means judge. You know, so here it is. You have this idolatry in the house of Elohim, and you have this idolatry with the judges of Israel. Everybody see that? Mm-hmm. And of course, this thing became a sin. And we see Jeroboam ordained the feast. He ordained his own Moedim, his own appointed time. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah. All right, so, you know, now, when Yah was using, when he was using Joash, Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king over Israel, and this is a different Jeroboam than the Jeroboam, son of Nebat, obviously. You know, it can get confusing because they both have the same name. But if you notice in verse 23, it says Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king over Israel, and in verse 24, says he didn't depart from the sins of Jeroboam, his namesake, the son of Nebat. Mm-hmm. See, these are two different kings.
Okay. Yes.
You know, if you don't be careful, you can just bypass right over that. You know, but these are two different kings with the same name. And they both were kings over Israel. Mm-hmm. You know, and they both caused Israel to sin in the same way. So now, moving on, Hosea chapter 7, verses 2 through 7. My next reader, please. But read 2 and 3 and then let me comment on that. Then we'll go on from 4 to 7.
And they say not in their hearts that I remember all their wickedness. Now their own doings have beset them about. They are before my face. They make the king glad with their wickedness and the princes with their lies.
Okay. I want us to think about this for a minute. It says, and they say not in their hearts that I remember all their wickedness. This is Yah speaking of the Israelites, saying that they say not in their hearts, you know, that he remembers all their wickedness. You know, and he goes on to say, now their own doings have beset about them, set them about, for they are before my face. You know, that word beset means like to surround. You know, so when Yah goes, you know, here it is, I'm going to try to paint this picture for you. You know, you have these people of Elohim, right? Mm-hmm. They say they're of Elohim, you know, but they're doing all this wickedness. And they're saying in their heart, you know, that Yah won't remember.
Right.
You know, they're saying in their heart that, you know, it's okay. He won't remember this wickedness. He'll forgive it. You know. And they keep doing it so much that it just surrounds them. And when Yah goes to try to look at them, all he sees is that wickedness. He can't see past that wickedness. The wickedness is always before his face. And it goes on to say they make the king glad with their wickedness and the princes with their lies. You know, here it is. You know, they go and they prophesy, you know, things that the kings want to hear and things that the princes want to hear. You know, they tell them whatever they want to hear so that they may gain favor with them. You know, this is what those priests of the lowest of people would do. What else could you expect from someone that's low down?
Right.
It said he took them from the lowest of people, not the highest. Mm-hmm. Amen. Mm-hmm. He didn't take them from the tribe of the Levites, that is, the ones that was attached to Elohim. Mm-hmm. He took them from the lowest of people. Mm-hmm. All right, verses 4 through 7.
They are all of them, kings, princes. The people are idolaters, hot like an oven heated by the baker. Leaves off from stoking it from the time of kneading the dough till it is ready for the fire. Then he heats the oven to stop the fermentation. Even so, these are idolaters. In the day of our king, the princes have made themselves sick with the heat of wine. He stretched out his hand with the scorners, for they have made ready their heart like an oven, while they lie in wait. Their anger smoke stoked all night. In the morning, the oven burneth as a flaming fire. They are all hot as an oven, and have devoured the judges, all their kings are fallen. And there is none among them that calleth unto me.
Okay, I'm going to go back up to 2 and 3 again. I'm not through with that thing yet. I haven't exhausted it yet. You know, for many of us today, many people today do the same thing, you know, because we have a tendency to read this stuff about those in the past and, you know, and think that we're, you know, better than that. You know, we won't succumb to the same things, you know, but truly, there's still many people who do all kind of things and think that Yah's not going to remember it.
Right.
See, but I'm here to tell you that Yah's memory is much, much, much better than mine. I may not remember it, but Yah not going to forget. In fact, everything that you do is being recorded. You know, you have what is called, you have actually have two minds. One is called the subconscious mind and one is called the conscious mind. Well, your subconscious mind records everything you ever do, everything you ever saw, everything you ever heard. So there's nothing that escapes your subconscious mind. So when you get before your judge and he played a take back for you, you know, you're not going to be able to say, well, I didn't know. Because he's just going to rewind to the point where you were told. You're not going to be able to say, well, you know, hey, I forgot. Because he's going to rewind back to the time when he reminded you. See, you're going to be without excuse. So it's best to live life today as knowing that he's watching.
Yes.
You know, my buddy's sister coined this phrase that I fell in love with. And what she said every morning before she leaves, she would look in the mirror. And she would, before she leaves, she'll say, what is Yah going to catch me doing today? She used to say, what is my God going to catch me doing today? You know. See, but if you ask yourself that question, maybe it'll bring that awareness to the forefront of your mind that he is watching. Because whatever you do that's not of him, he will catch it. You know, so let's learn the lesson from Hosea 7. You know, let's learn the lesson of what not to do. See, this is why all this stuff is recorded as to all the things that they did that did not please Elohim, as well as the things that they did that did please Elohim, is so that we might gain from it. See, they didn't have scripture to refer back to and say, well, when they did this against Elohim and then this happened, this so forth and so on. But we have much scripture that we can look back and see what pleases Elohim as well as what displeases him. Amen?
Right. Amen.
So we supposed to be the more mature of the group. Hence, Messiah would teach, last shall be first and the first shall be last. All right. Now, 4-7. Here it is. Yah is putting forth an analogy, if you would, of a baker baking some bread. And within this analogy, you know, I see this baker as being Hasatan. You know, he says, they are all of them, kings, princes, and peoples are idolaters. Like an oven heated by the baker who leaves off from stoking it from the time of kneading the dough until it is ready for the fire. Then he heats the oven to stop the fermentation. Even so, these idolaters. Okay, now imagine a baker. Here it is, he's obviously working with a wood-burning oven. You know, back then they didn't have the electric or the gas ovens, right? Amen?
Right.
All right, now, here it is. He heats the oven up. The ovens are depicted by the kings, the princes, the people, and the idolaters. Now here it is, Hasatan creates a fire within their hearts. This fire is like a desire, a lust, if you would, for wickedness, for lasciviousness. Okay? And within this oven, this fire is just kindling. Amen? It's just kindling. And it says that once he gets it started, he just lets it kindles. He leaves off from stoking it. Stoking it means to wake it up. You know, he just let the fire kindles. And then he started working on the dough. The dough typifies Israel. You know, the 10 tribes there. And he begins kneading the dough. Now, the more he kneads the dough, the more it leavens. And we just went through unleavened bread, and we talked about what, spiritually speaking and scripturally speaking, what leaven was.
Yes.
Leaven typified malice and wickedness, hypocrisy, and the doctrines of men. Okay? So now, here it is. We see all this leaven being kneaded into the dough until it's ready for the fire. See, now, if you see the kings and the princes and the idolaters, you know, that is the priests and even the elders, these are all the peoples that are in rule, right? Mm-hmm. Now, it's not too hard to see that the people who they rule over is like in them, you know, and that fire that's coming from their heart, that wickedness, that idolatry begins to cook that dough. You know,